how many people have had other people come to them for help about Git? Okay, a few people. All right. How many people feel you have a really good grasp on Git internals? No one. Okay. All right, so that's where we're going tonight. So now this is usually a 90-minute talk, so we're going to try and compress it a little. I'm willing to go over if we need to handle questions and answers. So now some other drastic step we're going to do here, which is very radical, is none of this has any practical part. So if everyone who has a laptop, if you could, except for the person who's recording this, if you could please close your laptops.
Wow.
I'll have your full attention to learn Git internals.
This is crazy.
All right, thank you very much.
Yeah, there goes the security.
What's that?
There goes the security.
Yeah, okay. All right. So we're going to start with preliminaries. These are terms you should all know. If you don't know, I'd be really surprised, but we're going to cover them so we have precise definitions for what we're talking about. First, etymology. Git. I'm an egotistical bastard, and I name all my projects after myself. First, Linux. Now, Git. That's what Linus Torvalds said about the name. Now, Git is British slang, if you didn't know that, for pig-headed, think they're always correct, argumentative. has anyone ever felt like Git would be kind of argumentative with you and you kind of use it?
Mm-hmm.
No? Okay.
Yes.
Yes, all right. Yeah, that's
especially
it.
When you're trying to, merge.
Yes. Yeah, so that's the etymology there. All right, version. What's a version? Standard English word. It's a particular form or variety of something that's different from others or from the original, right? Simple. The only point I want to make here is whether you use any sort of version control or not, you do have different versions of your files because you make a first draft, you fix a bug, you add a new line, right? Those are all versions, whether or not you save them. And definition of control is predictable change, the ability to put one's plans into action, execution of one's intention. So you have an intention, you want to do something, right? And you put that into action. That's what control is. So it's predictable. So if you're trying to control something, you're trying to do something, and you get all kinds of changes that you weren't predicting, would that be control? No, right? So that wouldn't be predictable change. So we put those together, we have version control, the ability to predictably change the form of your files, the ability to put into action your intentions concerning your project and its turning points. Now version, by the way, comes from Latin vertere, to turn, so it's by turning points. Now a point here, version control means you can do something, right? You can actually put your plans into action. Now a lot of people say version control, and what they really mean is version tracking. Right, just keeping track of all the different versions. But no, you should be able to do something. So you have a bug fix from one developer, you have a new feature from another developer, you want to combine those into one new version of your project that has both of those changes, right? So that version control should let you do that. All right, any question on those very basic terms? No, good. Repository. Did anyone in here think that repository was a computer term? Repository is like a coding term? No. It's actually a standard English term. This is from the 1828 dictionary. It's a place where things are or may be deposited for safety or preservation. Right, so you put your files in there, you put your project in there, it's preserved, it's kept safe. Right? Even if sometimes you are doing merges or fancy commands and you think it got lost, it's actually preserved and kept safe. Same about the word commit. It's a standard English word. You put into a permanent form or record for preservation, as by writing down or memorizing. So you commit the song to memory, you commit an agreement to paper, right? It's a permanent form, it's preserved. All right. Okay, file. I really hope you all know what a file is. Good. But let's give it a precision definition here. It's a collection of bytes on a computer that's given a name, and it's treated as a unit, as an individual unit separate from other units, right? Does anyone have any disagreement with that definition, or is it missing anything? I really want to know, like, is that technically accurate or is it glossing things over? Okay, good. About as simple as you can make it, right? Folder. Folder is a folded piece of cardboard that can hold paper documents and other folders. In other words, it contains files and their contents, and other folders and their contents. There's no such thing as a folder on a computer. Windows, to the contrary. What's the proper term for a folder on a computer?
Directory.
That's right. Why? You know, tell me why. What's that?
I just said you put things in it, that's all.
Yeah, all right. Well, it's called a directory because it directs. It's a listing of files and other directories with information about them. So it doesn't have the bytes, the file that's inside it, it doesn't have the bytes, and they're not part of that directory, right? It just has directions. It points to where are the bytes that can be found. So it has the name and directions to where the bytes of the file are located. So that's a directory. All right, any question? Okay. How many people in here feel that they have an excellent command of the subject of graph theory? Anyone? No? Okay. How many people have heard of graph theory? Good. All right. We're going to cover some very basics of graph theory. This is the underpinnings of Git. So graph theory, it's the mathematical theory of the properties and applications of graphs. There you go. Okay, what's a graph? It's a collection of nodes, usually shown by dots and given names or numbers, and edges, connections between exactly two nodes. Now that's actually a precision definition there. You can't have a connection between three nodes and call that an edge. You just can't. You can have three nodes and have an edge between every pair of them, but an edge is a connection between exactly two nodes. So here's a graph. All right, now you can see it has nodes, it has edges. One of the edges is drawn as a curve. Does that matter?
Nope.
Nope. That's right. This isn't geometry. It also doesn't matter that two of those edges are drawn crossing each other. Right? This is just an abstract representation. The edge just shows that the two nodes are connected. Now, how many graphs are on this slide?
Two.
One.
One. That's correct. It's not a connected graph, but it is one graph.
Okay, the left side is not a graph.
Yeah, yeah. Well, look at it. Look at the definition again. It's a collection of nodes and edges. It doesn't say that all the nodes have to be connected to all the other nodes, right? So that is one graph. All right. So now there's two main kinds of graphs. In a directed graph, each edge has a direction, usually shown with an arrow, right? A line with an arrow on one end. And in an undirected graph, there's no direction. Edges have no direction. All right. Here's an undirected graph. Simple? Any question about undirected graph? No? Here's a directed graph. Now, something I want to point out about a directed graph is that you can do something with a directed graph that you can't do with an undirected graph, which is have two edges between the same pair of nodes, one in each direction, right? All right, what are some examples? Can anyone give me an example of a directed graph?
State diagram,
okay, good.
Would a file system actually be a directed graph?
It would be, that's perfect. We're actually gonna get to that slide in a second, that's exactly right. How about other common examples, like even outside the realm of computers, graphs are actually quite applicable. Can you give me another example of maybe an undirected graph?
Or say a business flowchart.
Okay, yeah. Absolutely. Now, I'm glad you mentioned flowchart because the thing about flowcharts, sometimes you'll see flowcharts that have a bubble that has an action, and another bubble that has a question, and you have another bubble that says yes or no, right? So in a graph, all the nodes, like, graph is a mathematical abstraction, right? But in a graph, all the nodes should represent the same kind of thing, right? So if you're gonna have, let's say, a friends graph for Facebook, friendship relationships, then every node would represent a person, and every edge would represent the friend relationship, right? You wouldn't then have a node represent like someone's computer or someone's login or someone's operating system, right? You can have graphs of those things, but you wouldn't combine them in the same graph. So you'd have all the nodes be one type of thing. All right. Any question about directed or undirected graphs? Okay. Did I just make everyone shut up by talking? Are you, is that clear? Okay, good. I welcome your guys' questions and feedback, by the way. I really want to keep this interactive. That's, for me, is one of the big benefits of doing this as a live talk, so please feel free. All right, now there's a special kind of graph called a directed acyclic graph, or acyclic, if you're from Britain. A means without, it's the prefix, like asexual. So this is a directed graph that doesn't have any cycles, so it's impossible to get back to where you started by following the arrows. All right. There's a directed acyclic graph. There's another one. Now you notice if you ignore the arrows, you can't get back where you started. Like if I start here and I ignore the arrows, I can get back where I started. That's okay. I can't get back to where I started by following the arrows. All right, any question about directed acyclic graph? Can anyone give me an example of a directed acyclic graph? Well, I'll call them DAGs.
An intermediate form in a compiled language.
In a what?
When you compile your source code, intermediate form for that.
Yeah, that's right, yeah. Anything that has a dependency can be put in a sequence. My favorite examples is an electrical flow grid. Right, you have where it starts, and then it can flow to various places, right? So maybe it starts here, you have a couple different generators, right? But you don't have it flow back to where it started.
So like a family tree.
Family tree, yeah, well, family tree would usually be a tree. That's another kind of graph. But if you have various interesting things happen, then you could have a DAG. All right, here's an example of a DAG, getting dressed. Now, so here we have nodes represent articles of clothing, and edges represent a sequential dependency, right? You have to do this, you have to put on your undershirt before you put on your shirt. You have to put on your left sock before you put on your left shoe. But you can put on your tie and your left sock in any sequence. Although usually you probably put it in some sort of a sensible ordering. All right. Is this a directed acyclic graph?
Yes.
Yeah. How about that?
Yes.
Yeah. It all goes down. You can't get back to where you started. You can't get back to where you came from, let alone where you started, right? All right. Now how about this one?
Got a bunch of edges.
All right. Yeah. Does this look familiar to anyone, this one?
It looks like a commit log.
Yes, that's right. Alright. Okay. Next type of graph is a tree. A tree is a graph which has no cycles, no loops, right? Even if the directions of the arrows are ignored. A tree can be directed or undirected. Any directed tree is also a DAG, but not every DAG is a tree. Did you have a question?
No.
Okay.
Scratching.
No problem. So let's look at this is a DAG. Is this a tree?
Yes.
No.
No. Right, it says no cycles, even if the directions of the arrows are ignored. If I ignore the direction of the arrows, I can get back where I started. So it is not a tree, but it is a DAG. All right. Now here's an undirected tree, and here's a directed tree, also a DAG. Does this look familiar to anyone? What?
Yes, binary tree.
Binary tree. You know, it's funny.
So far.
I should probably add another node in this, just so I don't get that answer all the time. What else does it look like?
File system,
yeah. That's the answer I have in mind. But you're right, it is also a binary tree there. Because there's no node that points to more than two nodes. So it's a binary tree. All right. So that brings us to a directory tree. Directory tree is the structure of a directory with all of its subdirectories and files. This structure forms a tree, and it's a directory tree. Right? Directory tree. So you have your directory, right? Is this a directory or a file?
Directory.
Good. Is this a directory or a file?
Directory.
Good. Is this a directory or a file?
File.
Most likely. It could be a directory.
Good. That's right. At first glance, you think, oh, it has to be a file. Well, it could be an empty directory, right? All right, so now a point here, though, about Git. The way Git stores information, it doesn't actually have a way to store an empty directory. So in a snapshot of a directory tree as stored in Git, this would have to be a file. You can put an empty file into a directory and then have it store both, right? You can't store an empty directory in Git. So good. All right. Any questions about those preliminaries and the graph theory? There's two sections there. All right. So now we get to Git internals. First word here, and I'm actually missing a slide here.
Okay.
But here's the first word is object, the unit of storage in Git. It is uniquely identified by the SHA-1 of its content. Consequently, an object cannot be changed. What is SHA-1? Does anyone know?
Is that SHA?
That's right, hash. Secure hash algorithm 1. Does anyone not know what a hash is? Okay, good. I really need to add a slide on it. But a hash is a function. You understand function?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. A function that can take any size input and always produces the same size output. And here's some examples of outputs from SHA-1. And if you make a very tiny change in the input to secure hash algorithm 1, the input, you just change it just a tiny bit, the output will change drastically. So you can't predict, you look at the output, you cannot predict what the input was, but if you put in the same input twice, you'll get the same answer. So you can use it to check if two files are the same. All right. So let's look at that again. Objects, the unit of storage in Git, it's uniquely identified by the SHA-1 of its contents. So the contents, whatever you put into this object, gets passed through secure hash algorithm 1, and that output, which is 40 hexadecimal characters, gets used to identify that object. So you can't change the object, because if you were to change it, you'd have different contents. You'd have a completely different output to the hash function, and so you'd have a different identifier. So it would be a different object. What's that?
So this is basically a commit right here.
It's an object. There's more than one kind of object.
All right. Well, let's assume for a second that it's a commit. If someone else were to have another repository and commit something that happens to have exactly the same characters and everything, would it create exactly the same
SHA? Yes.
Huh.
That's right. But we haven't gotten to commit objects yet, but I will mention that since the commit object contains the name, email address, timestamps,
right,
that's not going to happen by accident.
Yeah.
All right. So SHA-1 examples. Good. Yeah, what's the question?
Yeah. What's the difference between a SHA-1 and a checksum?
Checksum. Similar concept.
Just different.
Yeah, well, checksum is a more general term. SHA-1 is a particular type. So, like SHA-256, SHA-512, there's all kinds of different algorithms that can be used for hashing. There's
so,
also
the checksum is usually, isn't it, the
MD5? MD5 is commonly used for checksums. The point is, checksum is a more general word. SHA-1 defines a particular algorithm used to get the output. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay, great. So blob is a big chunk of data without a clearly defined shape or form. It's just a collection of bytes. So remember, we said a file is a collection of bytes that has a name, and it's treated as a unit. So a blob is a file's contents without its name, without its metadata, with no knowledge of its type or structure. We have no idea if it's an image file, a text file, video, or anything else. It's just a bunch of bytes, right? So it's a blob of data. It's a big amorphous chunk of data. Any file that is stored in Git has its contents stored in a blob object named by the SHA-1 of those contents. Did I see a hand go up over there? You know, absorb that. So any file that you put in Git, you commit it, right? You store it in your repository for safety and preservation. It has its contents stored in a blob object. Now, we want to get technical here, because I can see there's some technical people who would catch me out on these sorts of things. So I'm going to make a new directory here. I'll just call it temp, cd into it. There's nothing here. I'm going to create a new Git repository. And let's look for a second at what hello into SHA-1, or is it SHA-SUM? SHA-SUM. All right, so that gives this, right? And this is just to demonstrate what I mentioned earlier. Now I'm going to change that to a lowercase h. and we see it's completely different. There's like no similarity there between the two hashes. All right, now let's add a new line here. Right, so if you're not familiar with printf, that's the output that I just gave, right? Hello, followed by a new line. And I put that into sha-sum, I get F572D3, so on, so on. All right, now let's put it into a file. Put it into file, file one. And I'm going to put that, make a blob object. Now, if we actually look, CE, so there we have our blob object. Now, this hash, okay, so it's the first two characters are used for storage. Hope I'm not losing anyone. The first two characters there, so, but look at this, this is different. CE01, and up here I got what? F572. So the answer to that, let's see, do I have, yeah, zlib deflate-f objects. We're going to look at the actual contents of this thing, and we're going to put it through, so it's blob6hello, right? There's actually another character in there that you can't see, which is, so we have blob space 6, null byte, hello new line. Now, if we take our printf command, and we say blob space 6, null byte, oops, I just overwrote my file. That's fine. and we see CE0136, so on, so on, right? Same sha-1. So, when I say any file that is stored in Git has its contents stored in a blob object named by the sha-1 of those contents, I'm just putting in here the note for technical accuracy, because I have someone asking me about deeper internals already, that the only addition to the contents of the file is a little bit of bookkeeping at the start. It says blob, it has a space, it says how many bytes in the rest of the file, H-E-L-L-O, new line, that's 6, and then it has the contents of the file. All right? Any questions about blob objects? Okay. Do you have any questions about blob objects? Okay. Good, so the next kind of object is a tree. Now in Git, a tree object is analogous to a directory. All right, one more point before we move on from blob object. Blob object is a state of a file, right? Now a file in your file system, you can change its contents, like I just did accidentally with file one, right? Can you change the contents of a blob object? Come on. You should all know the answer.
No.
Good, that's right. That's, well, you can't.
What do you mean anything anymore? Because
it's shown. Yeah, object cannot be changed. This sentence is probably the single most important thing in this talk. An object cannot be changed. That's going to be the answer to a lot of questions I'll ask. So keep that in mind. All right, so a tree object is analogous to a directory. But it's an object, right? So. What's one difference, without even going any further, what's one difference you can tell me between a tree object and a directory?
The tree can't be changed.
That's right. A tree object cannot be changed because it's an object. And just like any other object in Git, it's immutable. All right, so fine. So it's a state of a directory, right? So it's analogous to a directory. It contains a list of file names, each with the 40-character SHA-1 of the associated blob or tree object, right? So it's a blob if it's a file, a tree if it's a subdirectory, and the file modes, right? So that's if the file is executable or not, if the file is a directory, symbolic link, or a regular file. All right. Here's an example. Tree object, this is the contents you see. So we have what? We have mode, and you see this top one, 755, is executable. This next one, 644, is regular file, not executable. Next one, 040, what is this? Well, that's a tree. That's a directory. So it's called other stuff, and it's a directory. So it's this SHA is the SHA of a tree object. And then down here we have what? This is 120, so on, so on, blob. Symlink math, now that's just the name, but I put that name so you can see what it is. That's a symbolic length. and it's just stored as a blob, same as any other blob, except that Git has this mode in the tree object, so okay, Git, that's just the blob thing.
So does that mean that mode changes on directories are not stored?
Well, look, here's a, what mode change would you have on a directory?
I mean, like, if others can't read the directory, but I can't.
Good question. So let's look for a moment here. Is this big enough? Can you all see this? Okay. I'm going to make it a bit bigger.
Thank you.
Yeah. And open it again. Oh, I'll make it a little small. There we go. Okay, I do not recommend the man Git glossary. You'll get confused. But I do show a couple lines out of it. So, file system. Linus Torvalds originally designed Git to be a user space file system. So it's the infrastructure to hold files and directories. So to answer your question, in user space, you don't have the concept of others and of group and others, right? You just have your permissions. So, so no. And that's also why I improved my slide since the first slide I had of this. It's whether the file is executable or not. It's not standard Unix file permissions. So it's just executable or not.
In particular, it doesn't contain owner nor group.
Well, then you'd have to be running as a root.
That's what I'm saying. It does. The tree object doesn't.
That's right. That's right. It's just executable.
Yeah.
And then in the tree, of course, you have to be able to read it, mm-hmm. and you have to be able to execute it to get the contents. So that's a directory. Okay? All right. Any other question about tree object?
It means that the mode can never be any other number. It can only be 755 or 644.
Yeah, that's right. There are.
I'm asking if there is a possibility of 444 or
no, no, there aren't. For those last three, no. There are some other fancy things involved in the first ones that I haven't. Like these are basically all the ones you'll ever see.
Okay.
If you get really fancy, you might see something else, but not crucial.
This is probably obvious to everyone, but just so I make sure, no matter what the blob is, no matter how big, no matter how small, it's going to generate a 40-character shot.
That's right. Yeah. Including an empty file.
Okay.
Which would be blob space zero. Blob space zero and the like, right?
You haven't addressed the issue of hash collisions.
No, I haven't. The answer is that you've got to do the math. It's not going to happen. Yeah. You can look up the probabilities and so on, but
the SHA-1 could not secure something.
Yeah.
Because I would suggest to use SHA-256 above.
Yeah, okay, but get this. Git doesn't use SHA for security. It uses it as a checksum. So if you've heard that SHA-1 is not secure, that means that if you hash a password with SHA-1 and you store it, the hash, it is possible for someone to find out what the password is by trying multiple different passwords, because it's very fast, so they can try all sorts of different passwords into SHA-1 until they get the same output, right? But you're not going to find a collision. There are no known collisions. So you wouldn't use it for cryptography, but for checksum, it's perfectly safe.
You're not trying to hide the contents of the file, so that's...
Yeah, you're just trying to verify that the file is what you thought it was. Does that make sense? Okay, cool. Did you have a point?
Yeah, I just want to add that there have been... collision attacks when you don't use the full SHA.
Sure.
Right?
Yeah.
So like if you're using just the first 8 characters, right? They have demonstrated collision attacks on the kernel, the Linux kernel.
Okay.
Right? So they switched to using like 12 bytes instead of 8 bytes or
yeah.
16 bytes. I don't remember the exact number, but they had to make it longer for security.
Yeah. So Git only uses 40. So but you can abbreviate when you're referring to objects, you can abbreviate and just create the first however many bytes it takes to be a unique SHA. You do have to do at least 4. I think that's enough on that. I do want to get to commits and so on. So, but I love the interaction. So if you have more questions, just wait for the next time, ask. Revision is a particular exact state version of files and directories that is stored in Git. So we have a tree object, it's a state of a directory. Revision is a particular exact state of all the files and directories. So it's a tree object, a top-level tree object for your whole project and everything that it points to. So it's an exact state of your entire project. So here you have top-level tree object, And it points to blob object, tree object, blob object, tree object, blob object, right? All these ones on the bottom are blob objects. This whole thing together is a revision. But if you just took this as a tree object, that's not a revision. It's your whole project, right? Any question about revision? Okay, does everyone understand revision?
So in a minute, maybe you're going to demonstrate this, but if I make a new revision, then am I going to see multiple objects in my .git?
Well, if you didn't change the objects, if you didn't change the subdirectories, you'll have a new revision. Like this one will change. Okay, so that's a good question. That's a very good question. So let's say we change. So this is a snapshot of a state, right? We also have our copy on our working directory that is modifiable, right? It's on disk. So here's a file here. This is a blob object. It saves the state of the file. So now, in your project, you take this file and you edit it, and you create a new revision in Git. So this file, you're going to have a new blob object there because the content is different. Now this tree object contains a listing of all of those, all of the SHAs for each one of those blob objects. So even if all of these ones are the same, those won't be stored again. But this one has changed, so this will be a new tree object. And so this one will also be a new tree object. Okay. Does that answer that question? That was a very good question, but you asked. Is that another question? Okay. Good. So now we come to commit objects. How are we doing for time here? What time is it?
8:15.
Good, thank you. A commit object is an object which contains information about a particular revision. Every commit object references exactly one tree object. Never zero, never two. It's always exactly one. So it references a revision. So you have this commit object, and it says, this is the, now it references, now this whole thing is the revision, right? But you can get to all of it from that top level tree object. So it's actually inside the commit object is the hash of that tree object. Is that clear? Okay. So it references a revision. All right, what else does it have? So it has a SHA-1 of a top level tree object inside a commit object. And it also has such information as the author and date of the commit, the person who committed it, which is sometimes different from the author, and the commit message. Any question about these points? Actually, there. Illustration. So we have tree, revision. Note that there's no name for this tree object, right? This is the top level directory of your project. Git doesn't store the name of it, so you can rename the directory in which your whole project is contained, Git won't care. So it has that SHA there, has author, committer, in this case they're the same, they don't have to be, timestamp for each one, and a multi-line commit message.
The reason this matters to me is because I get questions from a lot of computer scientists like at Caltech that want to make the argument in a big collaborative project that a commit is the same as authorship, so they own copyright, something like that, like really, really applied. So it starts to really matter where these claims of authorship versus committer are coming. The committer is obvious because that's whoever runs the repository and has that permission.
Well, it's who makes the commit.
If you
want to get into legal points and, like, you know, determining legally who's the author, you're going to want to use securely signed commits. Right. So you can use your is it GPG key?
Okay.
Right. To sign a commit.
But what's the difference of a committer role to Git and an author role?
No difference.
Here's
an example. The most common example of how they could be different. There's lots of ways actually, but the most common example would be someone emails you a patch for your project. You apply the patch. Now, if you don't know Git, you might apply the patch and have it say that you're the author and the committer. But the best practice thing to do there would be to specify the author on the command line. So you committed it to the Git repository,
okay.
But the other person emailed you the patch, they're the author.
I never saw, I guess I've never had an opportunity to see where you would embed the author in the commit line.
Yeah.
We had a similar situation where we would who's Garrett for reviews, mm-hmm. and occasionally someone was gone on vacation that was the author of a patch, mm-hmm. someone else would commit on their behalf. So the committer and author were different. The author happened to be gone on vacation,
yeah.
so the manager committed. Mm-hmm.
Okay, but what I'm learning here is there is a way to encode
yeah.
the author, and we've just never, I've never learned it.
Yeah, it's
okay.
yeah, you just specify it on the command line. But by default, it's the same as the committer.
That's huge, thanks.
Okay, yeah. Any other question about commit object? All right, now there's, yeah?
Suppose,
I just want to say, you might be asking about the next slide, but I want to hear your question. Let's hear it.
Well, actually, this is a specific case.
Mm-hmm.
So I work a lot in pairing with someone else with a single commit, and we're using one of our GitHub names.
Mm-hmm.
Is it a good idea to put one of us as the author and the other one as the committer so that you both get credit on the same commit?
Not really.
Okay.
So we're not actually going to cover something in this class, but I'll ask you, Matt, have you heard of rebase?
Yes.
Okay. So with a rebase, it's very fancy, I'm not going to go into it, but a rebase is another way that the committer could change. If you're going to make a new commit that's going to match the class, maybe you're going to change the commit message, right? Now you can't change it because it's an object, it's immutable, but you can make a new one that points to the same revision. And so this stuff would be different, this would be the same, right?
Right.
That's the simplest case. And in that case, you'd have a different committer. It would change the committer when you did that. So that's not really a foolproof way to do that. You could, if you have it agreed on, but it's not really designed for that. Any other questions about commit object? Okay. So there's actually more to a commit object. This, I showed you line definition, right? The information about a particular revision, it references exactly one tree object, never zero and never two. And it has the author and the date and the person who committed it and the date they committed it and a commit message. Okay. Now, a tree represents a particular directory state, right? I think we've covered that. A commit represents that state in time. It explains how to get there. Also see parent. What's parent? Parent is a commit which is the logical predecessor. Okay? A commit which is the logical predecessor of another commit. So every commit object contains a list of its parent commits, if any. A commit may have any number of parents. All right, what does that mean? That's zero or more. Whole numbers. No fractions. Don't be specific. Any number of parents. So the one that we saw here, this commit object that we were looking at before has zero parents. Here's a commit object with a parent. Now it could have more than one, they would just be listed here. So that it has revision, same as before, parent or parents listed there. Now that's a commit object, that's the SHA-1 of another commit object. It says this is my logical predecessor. This is what came before me.
Does that have implications then for like where the head is?
Yeah, we're going to get to head. Yeah, but so parent. Now, does parent, this is something that I find people mix up all the time. So parent comes before or after the commit?
It's the prior commit.
So that's right. It comes before. All right. Now, does the parent point to this commit?
No.
It won't know about
it. It won't know about it because these objects are immutable. So the commit was created. The child commit doesn't exist yet. It cannot contain any reference to the child because it doesn't exist. And you can't add it later because objects are immutable. So you make the child commit, and you won't hear, by the way, ever the term child commit. But you make a commit that points to that commit as its parent. It points back, right? It points backward in time. So we have like this. We have a commit. And it references a revision, right? It points to this tree object, this simple object, and it points to its parent commit. And the parent commit also points to a tree object. Every commit points to one tree object, but commits can point to zero or more other commit objects as their parents. Any questions about that, parent?
Okay.
Yes. So do you eventually have just a list of parents that are every single commit that's been done to a repository?
No. Good question. No, it's just the immediate parent.
Okay.
Yeah. So you'd point to your parent, and that would point to its parent.
Okay.
But you could have both of those as your parents.
Why would you do that?
Why would you do that? Well, you probably wouldn't, but you could. I just mentioned.
Okay.
I'm a believer that you need to know what's possible before you can learn what's a good idea.
Okay.
So an ordinary commit has exactly one parent. An initial commit, the first one you ever make, has zero parents. And a commit with more than one parent is called a merge commit, and it merges separate lines of history. So, good. I like hearing that. So now most of the merge commits that you'll see in practice have two parents only. They can have more. It's called an octopus merge. You can have any number of parents. You could have 50, you could have, you could fill up your disk with a list of parents if you wanted to. So now another point. Let's look at this diagram again. Now, generally it's reasonable to assume that these blobs will have some relationship to these blobs. Right? This is the parent commit, and then you're going to make a new commit. You expect there to be some relationship, right? This is another point of just what's possible versus what's a good idea. They don't have to. So
you could completely change every single thing.
You could completely change. You could have nothing to do with it. This could be, you know, and it doesn't just have to be text files either. So this could be like the source code for your new project, and this could be like a video of ponies. It doesn't matter, right? So all it is pointers. So you get what's possible with the pointers, then you get what's a good idea and what will be make things easy to find, right? But of course, a lot of the other tools, Git merge and so on, are built on the assumption that they are going to have a relationship to each other. So if you want to do otherwise, you'll have to dig into the command line options and so on. But I mentioned that because you actually can. It's not unheard of to use Git as a database or a file system or like as the back end. So that's possible, so you should know that it's possible with the same internals you're learning now. All right, so ordinary commit, initial commit, merge commit. All right. So definition of commit in the Git glossary is much less complete than what we just went over, but sort of sums it up. It's a single point in the Git history. The entire history of a project is represented as a set of interrelated commits. All right, now, here's the million-dollar question. This set of interrelated commits, how are they interrelated? What kind of graph? That's right, it's a directed acyclic graph. And we have the definition of DAG from Mangate Glossary again. Directed acyclic graph. The commit objects form a directed acyclic graph because they have parents, so they're directed, and the graph of commit objects is acyclic. There's no chain which begins and ends with the same object. All right, and there can't be, because to do that you'd have to make something that hashed to, like, make a loop, right? Good luck trying that. Can't even get a collision. So here's a DAG of Git history. You know, we saw this DAG earlier, and someone correctly spotted that looks like a Git log, right? So you have initial commit. You see this has no parents. Okay, now, review. Which way do the arrows point?
To the parent.
To the parent, that's right. So where is the most recent commits made in this graph of Git history?
Top.
At the top, that's right. And it's a surprise. I've learned to go over that more than once because people miss it when I just say it once. So. You think time goes down, arrows go down, so this is the latest at the bottom. No.
They just point that graph upside down.
Yeah, the reason I put it like this is because this is how it looks like on the command line when you look at Git log. So. Initial commit, right, there's an ordinary commit. Now it has two commits pointing to it. Right, this is the parent of two different commits. That doesn't matter. Still ordinary commit because it just points to its single parent. Merge commit, two parents. Yes?
Yeah, that's the same thing as submitting a pull request. It's a merge command.
Well, yeah. Well, after the pull request is approved, you'll have a merge command. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. So, and by the way, so here is one. This. So look at this. This has two parents. Now one of them, if you follow its ancestor down, gets to the other parent, right? So if you take a look at this, I'm trying to think if I can phrase this as a question, I'll just tell you. This commit object points to a revision, right? This commit object points to a revision. Is there going to be likely to be any difference between this revision and that revision? No.
Which two?
This one and this one. So now, see, in this
it's the exact same thing.
It's going to be the same revision. Yeah, it points to the same revision. So the way the commit objects are structured here just gives information about the revisions, right? So now over here, so a commit object, as I said, the blobs don't have to be related. They also don't have to be different, right? You could have two commits in a row point to the same revision, the same tree object. But there, it actually will prevent that by default. If you try and make a commit when you have not made any changes, it will say nothing to do, unless you tell it specifically, allow empty, and then it will do that. So, but generally speaking, you have a commit, you have another commit, there's a change, there's a difference. So there's a difference introduced, another difference, and over here there's a difference, difference, difference. So then you have these two sets of differences, and you want to merge them, right? You want to take changes from here to here, and the changes from here to here, and combine them both. And so Git will do that automatically for text files. And actually, if you want to do it for binary files, you can set up your own hooks and like give it an external command it can run to handle the merges. You can do that. Not common, but you can. But yeah, so with text files, and then it merges them, right? So then you actually have a new revision. All right, so what happens if there's a merge conflict? What happens if you can't figure out how to automatically do all of these changes? Then you gotta fix it manually, right?
Fire up your editor.
Fire up your editor, fix it manually. What if you make a mistake? Well, Git doesn't have any opinion about it. It'll store whatever you give it to store. So you make a mistake, or as has sometimes happens with very, very beginners trying to merge conflict resolution, they store the conflicted version. Right, it has conflicts, it has two different versions in there at once, and some little markers saying this is from, right, and they just store that into the merge command. It's like, well, what is this? And then if you have another conflict on top of that, it gets really confusing. But yeah, so it has no opinion about it. So if you mess up, whatever you messed up on will be in there. And it might not bear any relationship to either of its parents, but that could happen. Good. So, I'm still more talking than I usually do on the side, but I think it's good. Any other questions about this?
Yeah. Are you going to tell us where the head is yet?
Yes. That's actually just about the next question. So here's what it looks like on the head. Well, couple minutes. We've already covered pretty much all of this, but just to show you, so this is what it would actually look like on the command line. In actual fact, I did something I'm very proud of here, and I have that slide. I make it a little smaller so you can see the whole thing at once. And git log one line graph. And make it smaller still. There we go. Here. Does this look familiar to anyone? That's a different organization of it, right? But look at it, you got these two commits here, there's some commits, right? So it forks off here, forks off, branches off, right? hey, it's the same graph. So yeah, that's what it looks like on the command line. Alright, and each one of these are the abbreviated commit shots. I told it to abbreviate, I could see the whole thing. But I chose not to. All right, I think that's enough on the Git history. So now we come to the next section, orientation. Now orientation is usually used to mean introduction. I'm using it in its exact sense, the determination of the relative position of something or someone, especially oneself. Now this is, what's your name?
Gail.
Gail. This answers your question. So we have this nice graph of history, but there's something we haven't answered. where are we in this big graph of history? There's all these different states of the whole project. Where are we? So that's what orientation is. Head, all caps, a pointer to Git's idea of the current commit. Now, you'll find other definitions for this online, and all of them will have lots of exceptions written after it. It's like, well, it's a pointer to the current something something, except when it's something else. And you try and understand. So this is the definition. It's actually, I have to write this myself. But this is the definition. It's always true. This is always true. This is, where are you in the graph? Right? That's your current commit. It could be wherever, but that's your current commit. Any point in the history of your project can be viewed by checking out an arbitrary commit. So what does that mean? It means you move the head to point to that commit, and you update your working directory to match the revision referenced by that commit. So here, before checking, so here's our working directory, right? Now you'll notice that in this one, it matches the revision referenced by the commit object that's pointed to by head, right? So this is our current revision, our current snapshot. Now, you check out, this is what happens. We move the head to point to a new commit, and we update our working directory to match the revision referenced by that commit. Okay?
But the take-home message is you've preserved all the other blobs and trees, even though, so there's persistence that, like in other systems, roll something back, it might go away, like I would use OpenRefine or something. It just disappears. Just the data goes away,
gone.
And you only keep where the head is.
That's right.
And it's different from an undo in that sense.
I guess, yeah. That's what's...
Yeah, it's different from an undo. If you haven't committed it, you know, keep in mind, commit is preserve for safekeeping, preservation, right? If you haven't committed it, It's not preserved yet, right?
Yeah.
So commit it. All right, so now what about when you make a new commit? So when you make a new commit, the commit pointed to by head will be the parent of the new commit. This is by default. Of course, you can specify other parents, you can specify multiple parents, you can do whatever you want, but just by default, generally, make a new commit, the commit pointed to by head will be the parent of the new commit, and the head will move to point to the new commit once it is created. So we have before new commit, after new commit.
Does that mean that if you wanted to, you could, if you're working in one directory that is a cloned repository, and then you make a commit, you could change the parent to be a different cloned repository entirely and have it still work?
Although yeah, you could. That would be pretty fancy, but you could.
Okay.
I'll just to mention, by the way, we have my back up quite a bit here. My first diagram of DAG, you might notice, has two initial commits, this one and this one. And I put that in there on purpose, but then later I got nicer slides. But so the question that this provokes sometimes is, wait a minute, how are there two initial commits? Sure, you can do that. I actually have done that myself when I started like a little sub project for one little script, and then I realized, you know, this actually belongs as part of this other repository, but I wanted to keep its history, so I just merged it in.
You can merge one repository into another.
The way I did it, yeah.
You can have multiple remotes.
You can have multiple remotes. I think that's how I did it. I don't remember. It was a long time ago, but yeah. There's all kinds of things you can do. That doesn't even touch submodules, by the way. You read up on submodules, you'll like it. All right. So head, right? You check out, move the head, update your working directory. You make a commit, you create the new commit. Its parent is whatever's pointed to by head, and the head moves to point to the new commit. All right. Any question about head, all caps? All right. So there's something that's sort of glossed over here. We have this nice big graph, and it has all these different commits on it. Now, how do you know they're there? How do you even get to them? Right, like how does Git know where all of these different objects are? So we have head, right? That's actually very predictable. And we can look in, I'm going to check out an arbitrary commit like I was describing. I could 93119, just pick one here. And here I am. I get a nice message. And I have my prompt set up all customized. All right, so but here's this 41 byte file, .git/head. If I look at just the last one commit, I see this. So what do you think is going to be that 41 bytes?
Yeah,
it's a 40 characters plus a new line. That's right, 40 characters plus a new, yeah. And it's 9331, so let's just cat it. cat.git/head. Okay, so 93119. All right. Now, if we actually look at the contents of that commit, 93119, we see this commit object, which I described and showed you slides of. But here's the real thing, right? Tree parent, 3052. If we look at that one, it has a parent. So we can follow this chain back up, right? So now let's go back to the slide.
But there's no way for it to just print out the SHAs in their relationships, like this SHA's like a
well,
lineage.
That's what I was doing before. And we say git log one line graph. That shows from the current commit. So this one is the current commit.
And those are just the abbreviated SHAs.
Yeah.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Yeah, and it's because I said one line. Now, if I take out the one line, there's all sorts of. You can do any format you want, right? Then I get the whole message and everything. But here's the point I'm getting at here. So here I am, and I can get to all of these. How do I get over here?
Branches.
What's that?
Branches.
Branches, that's right. So without the idea of branches, I would have to know the SHA-1 of this commit. I say, okay, git checkout, you know, A3E57. And then after I make a new commit, I'd have to keep track of what that one is, because otherwise I couldn't get to that one. I only wrote down A3E57. So that's what branches are. So now let's look. So now we define head, all caps. Now, head, lowercase. These are two different words. They're very different. Head is a named movable pointer to a commit object, also called a branch head, not to be confused with head. All caps. A Git repository may have any number of branch heads, like this. And that's how you get back to them. So if I check out down here, how do I get back? Well, I have my little pointer there, called a branch head, that's pointing to that commit, so I can get back to it.
Are those branch heads being imported?
Okay, so now I say git status, and I say on branch master, nothing to commit, working directory clean. Let's look at my head file again. What does it say? It doesn't say SHA anymore. It says refs, right? It's going to have a reference in there. Refs, heads, master. Now if we look, .git, refs, heads, master, this file is 41 bytes. I'm going to use a shell history expansion. Do the last argument of the last command. 7379. Right, there it is. Does that answer your question?
There's a refs directory that tells you
where the refs heads, yeah. It's just
so there's a it's part of the .git file.
Yeah, oh yeah, that I should mention. Everything in the entire Git repository is stored in this .git directory. Like that is the Git repository. But everything else is just my working directory.
And includes histories beyond just its own branch. It also includes all the other branches.
Everything. Everything is in there. You can poke around in... it's got all kinds of stuff. Branches, hooks, info, logs, objects, right? All this, everything is in there. Yeah?
I had a question. So in terms of how branch heads are used, mm-hmm. Let's say you have a team of four programmers and
they're working on a similar project, but maybe they're trying to create different functions or whatever. Mm-hmm. So they have four branches.
Yeah.
Could they periodically go ahead and merge to head and then fork back out?
They would merge to master.
So to speak.
Yeah.
And then once they've come to consensus, they can go ahead and split back out to branch heads to continue their work.
Yeah. In actual fact, we don't even cover collaboration in the one day, and then in the one day talk. There's just not enough time. And this is just the 1 hour talk, right? We don't have any other practicals. There is a full professional training that covers all these points.
Okay.
But the short answer is yes. But you'd actually each have your own copy of the repository.
Okay.
Just to add fun. But yeah, you should have your own branches also. So these are heads, lowercase, branch heads, right? So now earlier we said head is pointer to Git's idea of the current commit. That's true. It can, however, point on a layer of indirection. Head can point directly to a commit object, as we discussed before. That's called detached head state. Or it can point to a branch head. Any question about that?
So on this graph, is that a detached head?
That's detached head.
And then if the head was also where a branch head is, then it's...
No. If it's pointing to the branch.
Okay.
There's an exercise on the course that actually demonstrates that difference, but yeah, we have this is head is pointing to master. Now that's what I have. I just looked here, right? I say clear. I say cat.git/head, and it says refs heads master.
Right.
So it's pointing to the master. Now if we cat.git/refs heads master, right? Okay. So now if we say git status. I have it in my prompt, but. Just show you what you would use. Git status on branch master. Now we say git checkout 7379. Now I'm in detached head state, even though I'm on the same commit as master. Alright.
What does that do exactly?
Well, I think you're gonna love the professional course if you take it. I really do, because it's got exercises to cover all this. You get to explore it in detail.
Okay.
So
usually you're just going to go look at the state of the, at that time. You want to look and see at some other point in time, detached head. You're not actually looking to make changes. You just want to see what was going on at that time.
You can make changes. You can make commits.
But as you said, they'll be thrown away.
They'll be thrown away if you check out someone.
If you don't branch it.
Yeah. So, good. So that's detached head. That's on branch master. This is how you get back somewhere, right? You want to get back to where you came from. Or... You can make a branch pointing anywhere. It takes 41 bytes to make a new branch, right? You have to write 41 bytes, so it's very, very fast to make a new branch. All right. Any questions about that stuff so far? Branches, heads. Okay. Is anyone tracking? Has anyone just been lost a little bit? Has a little questions you want to say? Okay, good. You can still tell me if I said that too fast. All right. Stage is to move as military personnel. This is, again, English definition. To stage is to move, such as military personnel, supplies, or equipment. To move to or establish in a new base in preparation for a further movement or a planned operation. That's Webster's Third New International Dictionary. So you stage it. You put it somewhere. You move it to... in preparation for a further movement or a planned operation. So there's something that we have not covered yet, which is called the staging area, also known as the index. Now that is the collection of files, it's actually states of files, right, blocks. It's the collection of files that Git will include in the next commit, also called index. So let's get more precise. More precisely, it's the collection of file names and states, right, blobs, from which will be created the tree object referenced by the next commit. You're very precise there, right? So here we have, this is your index, there's staged files there. You see there's three of them. Here we have head pointing to commit, the tree object, so on. Maybe I should have two slides for this. But here we go. These staged files are used to create the new tree object. And that see, so they're blobs, right? Now we have a new tree object pointing to these blobs, and the new commit pointing to that revision, and head pointing to the new commit. So that's really what happens when you make a commit. we glossed it over before when we just said, before new commit, after new commit, right? Well, this is what's going on a little more under the hood. We have before new commit, after new commit. All right. Let's see what it is. All right. So new files or modified files in the working directory, you have to stage them. You have to add them to the index before they'll appear in the next commit. So there's this intermediate area before you commit something. So you have three areas for files. You have your working directory, you have your staging area, where you put files that you're going to commit, and you have the last revision that you stored, and all the revisions before that, stretching outward off somewhere, right? But these are the basic three places that files can be. Now, they could be different between these places. But in general, the simplest operation, you have add, which takes what's in your working directory, you say a particular file, and you put that in your index, in your staging area. You're staging it. You're moving it to this new location in preparation for the planned operation of committing it. Now, this is simplified because I really couldn't. I tried. I can't fit this all in one slide. So what happens there with that little commit arrow is what we just showed here, right? This and then that. That's really what happens when you have a commit. But here we're just going to show this little arrow. Now when you check out, you get it into your index and into your working directory.
Can you repeat that when you go into the working?
When you check out, when I say git checkout, what we said before about checkout, you can check out arbitrary commit. It will move your head to point to the commit that you checked out, right? And it will update your working directory to match the revision referenced by the commit you've checked out. Right? That's what we said before. That's true. It also updates your staging area. Okay? Yeah?
Just so I'm kind of clear, if you have you have files that are staged but not committed and you do a checkout, you're going to lose.
It depends what you check out. In actual fact, if you try and check, if you have files that are staged but not committed, that one I have to think about. What I will tell you is if you have files that you've changed in your working directory and you haven't added them or committed them, and you check out another commit, you check out a different commit object, if it can do that, if there was no change to those particular files between your current commit and the one you're checking out, it'll do that totally fine. If there is a difference, it will say, no, I can't do that. There's a difference. You have to commit these or stash them or do something with them before you check it, before you do a checkout. So it's actually very good about preserving changes you haven't committed.
So it won't override without your permission.
That's right.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, it's very safe that way. All right. Practical. There's a lot of theory we covered, right? Well, practical. Exercises with this material to gain professional skill and ensure ease of application are included in Git Foundations Unlocking the Mysteries. That's a full-day training. Exercises can be arranged on-site for your team. And much more material, fully covering the internals of collaboration, which we didn't touch. You notice we didn't even define what is a remote, right? Which you've probably all heard of, because in every tutorial I've seen for Git, step one is Git clone, and that really doesn't come as step one. So much more material, fully covering the internals of collaboration, unique exercises to really explore this, not just like monkey see, monkey do, what the minimum you need to get on with your job, but actually to really understand it. And days of advanced topics is included in Git Foundations from Novice to Guru. That's a professional 5-day training, which can be arranged on site for your team. And so to inquire about professional training, please contact me, mike@verticalsysadmin.com. If you have any questions, please reach out, feel free. And that's all I have. If I can get your email addresses, I have a survey. I usually give this, I already have email addresses. I don't have your email addresses, but I would love to get your feedback, both verbally or in writing. If we get it in writing, if we can get your permission to use it to help promote the training, I'd love to. If not, I still love your feedback. That's all I have. I'm open to any other questions before we end off. Any other questions? As long as they don't cover collaboration, yes.
When you said that when you check something out, it copies things to your working directory and it also copies things to the staging area, why does it copy things to the staging area?
Because the staging area is what's going to go into your next commit. So generally speaking, go back to that slide. Generally speaking, you're going to want the new commit to have some relationship to the last commit, right? That's just generally what you want. So if you check out, if you move to an arbitrary point on the graph, like you're here, now you're going to make a new, now so let's say we just came from here to there, we did a checkout. Now let's say that we just updated our working directory but not our staging area, right? So then when we go to make a new commit, we're going to have whatever was in there, right? So our revision, our new revision, the revision that will be referenced by the new commit will match that because we never updated our staging area. So instead, we do a checkout, we update the staging area also. It's like clean slate, right? So this is why immediately after a checkout, if you say git commit, nothing will happen because your staging area was just updated to match the revision you're now pointing to.
Right.
So you say git commit, it's like, oh, it's the same. I won't do anything. Unless you force it to, right? Does that answer your question?
Yes.
Okay. Any other questions?
Along with that, so if you were to reset your head to an earlier commit and then make revisions there and then commit that, does that automatically create a new branch, or what happens to the other files that you did, the other commits that that is the parent of?
You mean that points to as its parent?
Yes. What happens to the things that are upstream of that?
Upstream. I'm not totally sure I understand the question. Let's go to a diagram so I can understand it.
So, like, you. So, I'm thinking of this like Back to the Future. You go back to the past, right? And then you change something in the past. What happens to everything that happened in the future from that past?
It's still there. It's immutable. Objects are immutable. They don't disappear.
So where does the new commit exist in that structure?
Well, it wouldn't fit in this nice, pretty slide. But it would be here, pointing here at this parent.
Okay, so it actually does kind of create a new branch in that sense automatically?
No, a branch is a movable pointer to a commit. So in the English sense of the definition, that you have a branch is something which divides or goes off in different directions, yes, it creates a new branch.
So what is this thing that we have created in that case?
Well, it's a new commit. And since it's not pointed to by any branch. It's not reachable. It's not an ancestor. Okay, terminology here. This is the branch head.
Right.
This is the tip of the master branch.
Right.
This commit object is the tip of the master branch. And sometimes the master branch or on the master branch is used to refer to the tip of the branch and all of its ancestors.
Okay.
Okay. So we've just made a new commit that's not on any branch. In other words, it's not reachable from the tip of any branch, right?
Right.
That is called a dangling commit.
Oh.
Okay?
All right.
All right. Great questions, I love it.
For the dangling commit, doesn't that eventually get garbage collected and disappear?
Yes, it will.
You?
Yes, it will. If you don't create a branch to point at, or a tag, tags are covered in the full day training, but they're very simple. If you don't create something to point to that, then yeah, it will eventually get garbage collected.
All right. I had a question about staging area.
Yeah.
I sometimes forget to do a git remove and I just delete a file.
Mm-hmm.
And then I get into this state where I want to commit the fact that I've deleted the file, but I feel like git is fighting me on that. And I don't understand how to get the staging area right in order to commit it.
So I say it's sort of peculiar. What you'd have to say, you could say git rm. But you're not going to get tab completion. That's
yeah,
the only thing.
That's the only annoying part.
Fruits. I don't have tab completion anymore because it doesn't exist. Mm-hmm. I say git rm fruits, and git status, and I see now it's green. The meaning of all this green, red, all this stuff is covered in the exercises. It's very simple. but very important. But yeah, so that's now, it's green, and there's no red. That means that the staging area and the working directory match, but the staging area and the head, the revision reference by head, do not match. Okay. So there's something ready to be committed.
So just do a git rm and I'll get myself back into a good state.
Yep. And also, by the way, another note on safety, git rm will not remove a file that has changes. If you made changes, you didn't stage them, you say git rm, it will not remove it. It'll say, hey, you have changes. So definitely use git rm and git move, git mv, by preference to rm and move, because you can avoid data loss that way. All right? Let's see, how are we doing on time? All right, just after 9. Hey, finished on time. So thank you very much for coming. Are there any closing announcements? Should I turn it back over?
Anyone else have anything to announce?
Or should I, it's just social time and we gotta go.
Are you scared?